Okay, so this is a city. Here are all the people living in it. People of all different colors, ages, wealths, and incomes. Except they don't all live together in the same place. They're separated into different parts of the city by what color they are, what language they speak, and how much money they have. And those different parts of the city look quite different. The parts that are whiter and wealthier tend to have green spaces, grocery stores with nutritious organic food, and of course the money to buy it, and are often far away from pollution-emitting freeways. The parts that are poorer and more diverse tend to have industrial sites, heavy-duty diesel-polluted ports and highways, and hazardous waste, all things that the city relies on to run properly, but that heavily pollute the air and water. And even if they had those grocery stores with nutritious organic food, most residents there couldn't afford it anyway. How did this happen? Well, this segregation can be traced back to race-based zoning and housing policies, but it wasn't always as deliberate as plain old racism. Some separations can simply be traced to poor land use planning. And as a result, these residents of the same city live very different lives. Say the city realizes it has an emissions problem. It comes up with a plan to reduce air pollution, plant more trees to suck up the carbon, or start a cap and trade program. But those trees get planted in the neighborhoods that are already green, and the factories that are spewing toxins into the air just buy more carbon offsets and keep spewing their toxins. The benefits of these programs are enjoyed by the communities that are already doing just fine, and the communities that were hurting most from all that air pollution, well, they're still hurting. This isn't just an imaginary city, this is the story of real cities all across the US where people might live in the very same area code, but their race, ethnicity, or wealth and income bracket causes them to experience wildly different quality of air, water, and life. In fact, it can even mean that they also experience different deaths. That's how serious this stuff is. This kind of inequity expands far beyond cities, too. Rural areas are full of commercially valuable resources like oil and coal, and they're also home to indigenous and low-income communities. But when those resources are extracted, those communities don't see any of the money, and they end up with all the air and water contamination that's left over from the extraction. And we even see this injustice on a global level, like in small island nations that are forced to directly confront the consequences of rising sea levels, but haven't played any significant role in the industries that are causing climate change. These peoples are sometimes forced to flee their homes because their land is literally going underwater. But the very states that did play a hand in creating climate change don't have migration policies to accommodate them. So when we talk about environmental justice, we're talking about how we can try to break down and reimagine a system that's built up on these inequities. A system where those who are already disadvantaged because of their race and economic status are made poorer because they're unable to profit from the resources that the world depends on, and are made sick, or worse, by the environmental contamination that comes with extracting those resources. Social inequities are intimately tied to the environment. That's why social justice is an environmental issue, too.